It's a sort of been a 100-year story, really, way back in the beginning of the sort of last century, certainly the second decade of the last century, the 1920s. The Bloomsbury Group in Britain was one of the few cultural vanguard groups that were pushing for what would now be called an equality agenda on this issue and many others. And they were as under pressure as politically incorrect social conservatives are today. We've seen a total reversal in the stormscape of the sky. You know, everything has changed. All of the landmarks have remained the same, and yet the atmosphere around them has changed utterly. 100 years back, people with these ideas were under deep cover. They were frightened for their careers and their reputations. If it was revealed they had these sorts of ideas, they had ways of recognising each other's views, and they had extended circles and networking and contacts to keep their views separate from people who weren't as quote-unquote progressive or, in their terms, as up to the mark as they thought of themselves. It's quite interesting because, of course, some of the great espionage scandals of the 20th century involving the security services of both Britain and the United States of America are rooted in these sorts of cultural networks, because the Bloomsbury Group was an open cultural network up to a point with closed features. But the Apostles Group at Cambridge University and its equivalent at Oxford University and its equivalent in certain colleges of London University was more of a closed, elitist cultural circle, and it was a communist circle, a general ultra-liberal ethos through which these circles floated. And there was very much a homosexual circle. One of the key spies and MI6, MI5 traitors in the later decades in Britain, Anthony Blunt, who went on to be the surveyor of the Queen's pictures, believe it or not, and was sort of pardoned and yet not pardoned and later revealed as a spy by Margaret Thatcher and stripped of all his various establishment honours. He was part of a homosexual circle that overlapped with these other circles of ultra-liberalism and of politically correct non-conformism. These were ideas which were totally at variance with the society in which they lived. The society was a conservative, in British terms, morning chronicle society. Those were the attitudes that prevailed then. And these people were really up against it. And this issue of all issues was a trigger issue, because it's an issue about which the majority of people who don't think about these issues at all have an instantaneous judgment, an intuitive judgment, a physiological judgment, because despite the ideology that says that 40%, and more accurately in terms of the ideology, 10% are inverted or homosexual in sexual orientation, it might be as low as 1.5 to 2% for either gender, which is a very small number of people. And yet the politics of getting them civic equity has been an enormous struggle, and yet it's been conducted when in some ways there was no real need to do it, in a strange way. At times it's almost not been about homosexuals, it's been about the effect you can have on society by promoting them and it. Now, the so-called gay liberation movement has always existed amongst homosexuals themselves, but its heterosexual supporters, because the bulk of the left that supported them, of course, didn't share their orientation, but shared their desire to change society absolutely in all sorts of stages and at all sorts of levels. Traditional Marxism had very little to say about sexuality, about drugs, about the culture of bohemianism, and about decadence. Marxist-Leninist regimes, of course, have been highly socially conservative and have been quite toxic about issues of decadence and retain the ultra-conservative trade union attitudes that often prevailed on the old left at the beginning of the 20th century. Communism tends to do this. When it's in opposition, it advocates the maximum degree of breakdown and debility and what conservatives call decadence. But when in power, it reverses that and has a very socially conservative mantra. But to return to the movement itself, the movement didn't really become observable until the 1950s and 1960s, when it was part of the general current that reverberated within and beyond the 60s cultural revolutions that spread into the 1970s. The term gay and its etymology is quite interesting, of course, because technically it's a 19th century word, and it means a prostitute, or it means somebody who's louche and somebody who's decadent in their sexuality. In Victorian England, the term gay meant essentially a woman who was easily available for sexual usage. And the term gay, meaning sexual outsider, mountebank, hustler, somebody who uses their sexuality in order to get on, somebody who is in some ways a sexual criminal. That was the original word, because, of course, its counterpart is straight. And in criminal jargon, those who are not criminals are straights. They're the ones who obey the rules. They're the nerds, you see, in this sort of quasi-criminal way of looking at things. The people who obey all the rules and stick to the lines and who work for a living and this sort of thing are regarded as straight, or having gone straight, or not deviated from a straight straight path. This idea that one is different and is transgressive in the sexual area is where the term gay comes from. It's got nothing to do with being happy and carefree, as most people believe. So even the origin of the word is ideological, and the whole movement was ideological because they decided to invert National Socialist motifs for the way in which homosexuals were treated. So the pink triangle became a symbol of pride, and the inversion of stereotypical prejudices against them became an object of correlative in relation to their own identity. And that's what that particular movement picked up. The movement began in a very militant and vanguard way. It softened over time because the bulk of homosexuals are not interested in militant vanguard politics. So they've softened over time. They've changed their objectives over time. On the issue of marriage, traditionally, the gay movement was always opposed to marriage for homosexuals, believing that it was a bourgeois construct that heterosexuals engaged in. And the whole point of them was that they were different people who had a different lifestyle and that bourgeois marriage was not part of it. The liberal left has claimed this space for itself, and the idea that a small proportion of them who wish to marry should have the right to do so outside church in civic ceremonies that go beyond civil partnerships, it's largely an initiative of the bourgeois left. It's not really an initiative of the far left. It appears far left to people on the other side, but they on the whole are relatively indifferent about it. They'll tick the box for it, but it's not something that they cheerlead particularly. Homosexual marriage legislation, something that's being brought in by a conservative-dominated government. I think it's become a tokenistic thing to prove how moderately right on and progressive one is. The reason for its adoption by the British Conservative government is purely political positioning involving the present leader, Cameron, the Liberal Conservative, who's not right-wing or reactionary on social issues. One of the ways he could run against his own party and prove his independence and the fact that he wasn't really right-wing but was a conservative of an allegedly modern character, a sort of civic neoconservative without the foreign policy accretions, if you like, was to champion homosexual marriage in the teeth of his party's sullen opposition to it, because the Tory party doesn't like it at all, and there's going to be a large-scale rebellion which may scupper his project. It's also considered to be a meaningless sort of gesture as well, because hardly any of them want to get married. And so what it is it's a chattering classes issue. If you had a vote on it, the vote would be quite close, because the issue has been forced onto the agenda to such a degree that liberal attitudes towards it are much more prevalent than they used to be. There would be a majority against a marriage because they've got civil partnerships anyway, and most people would say that's enough. And there's a strong lobby that's opposed to marriage, particularly a Christian lobby, which involves the ex-Archbishop of Canterbury and other people. So it probably won't happen under a Tory government, actually, but it will happen under a Labour government at some time in the future. It's become a shibboleth because heterosexuals wish to support tokenistic gestures that make them feel good. It's always been important in one sense because it's played to elites. The elites of Western society have often been segregated along gender lines early in life, segregated by schooling, marriages often semi-arranged. Your nanny and sisters and your mother, aunts and female relatives were really the only women that many young men met until they were 20. Even then, universities were segregated, at least at colleges, although you did get to meet the opposite sex at that time. So this hothouse atmosphere at upper class and upper crust schools, particularly in Western Europe, especially in Britain, is the stuff of folklore. The issue of the dandy and people who stand outside by virtue of style, and the importance in the arts, where this minority has been extremely radically represented, if not overrepresented. Their representation in the arts can be 15-20%, and yet their percentage in the society may be actually proportionately very small, except when they all group together in particular locales, which is one of the tactics that's used. So yes, it's always existed, it's fluctuated. One of the biggest tensions holding it back in Western society is Christianity. Christianity has always been quite biblically literal about inversion and homosexuality, and has always condemned it. This is not to say that there's always been Christians who've had a liberal view about it, but at the end of the day, Christianity is one of the major sanctions upon it, and as secular Westerners struggle to get these civic equality measures onto the statute book, it's the evangelical Christianity, with a certain element of reactionary Catholic Christianity added in, that's conducting the last stand, as it were, really, because this is a major issue for them, because it's literally condemned in the Bible. So for them, it's a cardinal matter. It's very important, indeed, for all three religions of the book, Judaism, Christianity and Islam. It's actually a central issue, which is why they tend to debate it so much, because it's a totemic issue, it's a touchstone issue. For the broader society, it's not really an issue. The bulk of heterosexuals rather not think about it. That's their attitude, actually. actually. German experiments were quite notorious because, of course, these were conducted by a communist state, and many of the experiments were relatively benign, but some were not, because most of them were conducted under the aegis of the Stasi. And they were conducted because Honecker and the elite of the East German vanguard wondered why homosexuality existed so much in East Germany. Now, they thought that homosexuality was a bourgeois perversion, and they believed that state socialism had been achieved in Eastern Germany, and communism, the perfection of it, was well on the way, indeed was being achieved, actively so. So why did it still exist? And with the literal mindedness that communists always have, they took groups of homosexuals and asked them to write out their life histories, and then they let many of them go. Others, they actually did experiments on by showing them heterosexual pornography and so on, which presumably had to be smuggled in from the West, and seeing what their response to it would be, and tying them to electrode machines and to a lie detector tests. A proportion of them that were left, they went in for much more direct action, which was illegal, but was given state sanction, in that some of these individuals were shot, and the scientists operated on their brains. And they discovered something which has become normative in Western medicine in the last 20 years, that heterosexual women have the same brains as homosexual men, because men and women have different brains. And homosexual women and heterosexual men have the same brains. So this leads to the theory that you have the brain of a man in the body of a woman, and you have the brain of a woman in the body of a man. And this is one of the later scientific theories which seems to be justified by fact. There's been a definite silence about this theory. It's often the liberation movement concerned never wants to discuss their own case. They want to discuss the dynamic agenda whereby they're given more and more civic equality in the social space. The West has replicated these experiments by using the tissue samples and the brains of people who left their bodies to science in the normal process of evaluation. There's only one, and that's the extraordinary example that these experiments were done in East Germany, which was a communist regime supported by the Stasi secret police, who used to finance and arm the Red Army faction in West Germany to spread chaos and mayhem. And yet, here we have the most illiberal, dysgenic type experiments being conducted, all in the name of socialism, which would literally horrify the whole liberal left. All those people that you met in Brooklyn, getting people to sign up for civic equality in marriage. Think what they'd think about those communist experiments in East Germany. And yet, it's part of the same continuum that they're on.